What do you see when you look in the mirror? A loser, a failure. Does every scar determine who you are? Maybe don't look, just turn away. If every day is like yesterday, when's it gonna change? What do you hear when you're all alone? Stranded at sea on a stepping stone. There's a cloud inside you, it's welling up. Your eyes are holding back a flood. It's safe to come undone. You're not worthless, you're precious. You're not left out, you're wanted. You're not invisible with your shining soul. Love has spoken, you are chosen. You sat on the side and you tried to hide it.
Silence, quiet.
But deep in your heart there's a burning fire. Whoever told you that you're not strong, today's the day you're gonna prove him wrong and sing your victory song. You're not worthless, you're precious. You're not left out, you're wanted. You're not invisible with your shining soul. Love has spoken, you are chosen. You're not left out, you're wanted. You're irreplaceable with your shining soul. Love has spoken, you are chosen.
Hey, good evening, church. How are we doing? Good? Good. Why don't we stand and we get into a time of worship together this evening? Let's pray. Father, we come before you. Lord, there's nothing like singing your praises, Lord, in your presence. And Jesus, right now, Lord, we surrender to you. God, we lift our voices to you. God, I lift up everybody who's coming, Lord. I pray, Lord, that they would just offer you their praise, God. We have so many reasons to thank you. We have so many reasons to shout who you are, Lord, and just sing of your goodness. And so, Lord, would you inhabit our praises, Lord, this evening? God, we submit under your authority, under your leadership, Lord, this evening. So have your way by your Spirit. Fix our eyes on you, our thoughts. Lord, we fixate our eyes on you as well. So we ask all these things in Jesus' name. We all say amen, amen. Let's worship, church. The God who was, we worship the God who is, we worship the God who evermore will be. See, open the prison doors, he parted the raging sea. My God, he holds the victory. There's joy in the house of the Lord, there's joy in the house of the Lord today. We won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. We won't be quiet. We're gonna shout. Saves. We sing to the God who always makes a way. 'Cause he hung upon that cross, then he rose up from that grave. My God still rolls away. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We're gonna shout out. We were the prisoners, but now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by his grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. 'Cause we were the beggars, but now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, but now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by his grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We're gonna shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. We won't be quiet. Gonna shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We're gonna shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is sure in this place. We won't be quiet. We're gonna shout out your praise. Oh, oh, oh. We shout out your praise. We won't be quiet. We're gonna shout out your praise. Amen, amen. that once was crowned with thorns is crowned with glory now. The Savior knelt to wash our feet. Now at His feet we bow. The one who wore our sin and shame, now robed in majesty, the radiance of perfect love now shines for all to see. Sing it together. 'Cause your name is victory, and all praise will rise to Christ our King. Your name, your name is victory, and all praise will rise to Christ our King. Sing the fear. The fear that held us now gives way to Him who is our peace. His final breath upon the cross is now alive in your name. 'Cause your name is victory, and all praise will rise to Christ our King. Your name is victory, and all praise will rise to Christ our King. By your Spirit I will rise from the ashes of defeat. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. In your name I come alive to declare your victory. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. In vain was borrowed for 3 days. His body there would not remain. Our God has robbed the grave. Our God has robbed the grave. His victory, and all praise will rise to Christ our King. Your name is victory, and all praise will rise to Christ our King. By your Spirit I will rise from the ashes of defeat. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. In your name I come alive to declare your victory. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. Your name, your name. the banner, and all praise will rise to Christ our King. 'Cause your name is victory. And all praise will rise to Christ our King.
To the
declare that over our church, over our lives, God. And God, right now, we just praise you. We pray that you be glorified. In Jesus' name, we all say amen, amen. Why don't we fix our eyes to the screen for a video?
Hey, square.
I am not a square. I
think we should invite Greg this weekend.
What's this weekend?
These people are hippies, rebels against old-fashioned authority.
I think these kids need help.
They need is a bath.
You're passing judgment on people you know nothing about. Maybe that's why your church is so empty.
When God walks in here, brings me a hippie, I'll ask him what it's all about, because I do not understand.
This house has a very good vibe. There is an entire generation searching. Just in all the wrong places. If you want to reach my people, you need to speak to them in a language they understand.
If I bring them in, I'm going to lose my job.
We can only walk through doors open to us. In your church, that's a door that's shut.
You've probably noticed we have some guests here today. I'd like you to meet my new friends. Welcome.
They don't belong here. Half of them aren't even wearing shoes.
They're staining the new shag carpet.
They need our help. If you feel like you're misunderstood and judged, you will find forgiveness and freedom right here.
That was awesome.
Now that door is open any time of day. And if there are some who don't like that, well then that door works both ways.
All right, Pastor, let's begin.
I was almost done with this, but then you did what nobody else would even dare.
This thing that we found, I feel like I belong.
You're gonna need a bigger church.
Our country is a dark and divided place, but now there's hope and it's spreading.
This is your home, and I want you to tell all your friends about it.
Well, good evening, church. So there you have it. That's one of the trailers for the Jesus Revolution movie that we are going to. And we have the privilege to be streaming here at our church next Wednesday night. We're one of the first and very few churches that they're going to allow to stream this movie before it comes out next month. It's a movie of that Pastor Greg Laurie got together with some producers and put together, which depicts the Jesus People movement and how Calvary Chapel started in the early 70s. So it's going to be a great film. Actually, Pastor Art has already seen it, so he recommends it. So come out that night next Wednesday. Now, just a couple things. They do want us to RSVP, the producers, those of them that are streaming the movie. So we did mention that last week. So RSVP through a link that's on our website. If you go to ccdowney.com, our homepage, you go there, you find the RSVP link for the movie. Go to an RSVP there, because as you come in, we're going to be checking everyone in through the RSVP, because as we assume that many people are going to want to come and watch it, we want to make sure that you're here as well. Prepare to be here on time. We're going to start right at 7 for the movie, and it is a two-hour movie. So for those of you with kids, just kind of be mindful of that. It is going to be a two-hour movie, 2 hours long for the evening. But it is going to be a blessed time, and the Lord is moving and doing some wonderful things in our church. So to watch this and remember what he did back then, and praying and believing that he could do it once again, and he could do it in and through our church. So it's going to be exciting. So come out, RSVP, send it to your friends and family. Be here early for parking. Be here early to sit in. It's important that you do so. And let's enjoy next Wednesday. They're going to send in a step and repeat banner for people to take pictures. There's going to be a red carpet here and all of that. So they're going all out when it comes to that. We do want to announce and have been announcing the LA Pastors and Leaders Conference, which is now under a month away, 3 weeks away. So Pastor Jeff's going to be here, a few other pastors from the LA region, even from the East Coast. It's going to be a great time. It always is. And this is for all of us once again here at church, those serving in ministry, those serving in leadership, those that have a desire to serve, or those that are simply say, you know what, the Lord has called me to serve
you know, whether it's my workplace or somewhere else. You know, I'm a believer. I want to be equipped. I want to be encouraged, exhorted that we can come out, sign up. The registration for the conference includes a night of worship with Pat Barrett, which sings a few of the songs we sing here at church. So it's going to be a blessed time. Sign up. Make it a point to be here. You're going to be blessed, church. Also, this upcoming Friday at 7 p.m., our One Accord Marriage Ministry is back. They're going to be meeting in the fellowship hall at 7 p.m., so be there. And then also, Revive Downey is taking signups outside in the foyer tonight for this upcoming January 14th at 8 a.m. They'll meet in the fellowship hall. They're going to be going out, of course, and evangelizing, reaching the community and those around us. So step out in faith. It's the beginning of the year, and we just had a beautiful, wonderful night of prayer, right, a couple weeks ago. And now step out again and say, Lord, use me to share my faith. Use me with the body of Christ going out and witnessing. So step out, come and be a part of what the Lord is doing here in our church. Why don't we pray as we continue to worship the Lord this evening? This is in Psalms 98, verse 1. Oh, sing to the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous things. His right hand and his holy arm have gained him the victory. And Lord, we're so thankful and grateful this evening, Jesus, because we have come to sing to you, Lord, our hearts and a song, God, because you've done marvelous things, Lord, and you do them in and through our lives. You're faithful. You cannot deny yourself. It's your character, Lord. And it's your right hand of strength, your holy arm of purity that have gained you on the cross the victory, Lord. And we stand, Lord, as believers and as your sons and co-heirs with Christ. We stand in a position of victory. So we've come this evening with, Lord, you know the state of our hearts, different trials and problem circumstances, Lord, but we know that we come to worship a God who's a victor, who's already won. Lord, so we lift to you our praise and our worship. We ask, Lord, that as we give even online and on our way out, Lord, that you would bless it, stretch it, and use it for all of your purposes. Go before this evening, speak to our hearts, God, and that, Lord, we would have come as we are, but we wouldn't leave as we came this evening. It's in your name, Jesus, that we pray, and we all said, amen.
Through generations, I know that you will keep your covenant. I'm calling on the God of Moses, the one who opened up the ocean. So I need you now to do the same thing for me. Oh God, my God, I need you. Oh God, my God, I need you now. How I need you now. Oh Rock, oh Rock of Ages, I'm standing on your faithfulness. On your faithfulness, I'm calling on the God of Mary, whose favor rests upon the lowly. I know with you all things are possible. I'm calling on the God of David, who made a shepherd boy courageous. Cause I may not face Goliath, But I've got my own giants. Oh God, my God, I need you. Oh God, my God, I need you now. How I need you now. Oh rock of ages, I'm standing on your faithfulness. I'm standing on your faithfulness, on your faithfulness. Your faithfulness, I'm standing. 'Cause you heard your children, then you hear your children. You are the same God. You are the same God. You answered prayers back then, and you will answer now. 'Cause you are the same God. You are the same God. You were providing then, you are providing now. You are the same God. You are the same God. You moved in power then, God move in power now. You are the same God. You are the same God. You were a healer then, you are a healer now. You are the same God. You are the same. Same God, you are the same God. Oh God, my God, I need you. Oh God, my God, I need you now. How I need you now. Don't rock, oh rock of ages, I'm standing on your faithfulness, on your faithfulness. Oh God, my God, I need you. Oh God, my God, I need you now. How I need you now. Don't rock, oh rock of ages, I'm standing on your faithfulness, on your faithfulness. Come and fill me again. Come and fill me again. Come and fill me again. And oh Lord, you're beautiful. Your face is all I see. And when your eyes are on this child, your grace abounds to me. And I wanna take your word and shine it all around. First help me just to live it, Lord. And when I'm doing well, help me to never seek a crown, for my reward is bringing glory to you. And oh Lord, please light the fire that once burned bright and clear. Replace the lamp of my first love that burns with holy fear. 'Cause I wanna take your word and shine it all around. First help me just to live it, Lord. And when I'm doing well, help me to never seek a crown, for my reward is giving glory to you. Can we just sing just the voices? Let's sing, I want to take your word. 'Cause I want to take your word and shine it all around. To live it, Lord. And when I'm doing well, help me to never see a crown, for my reward is giving glory.
Lord, we thank you because we can come into your presence right now, Lord. And Lord, to give you the glory, the honor that you deserve, we ask right now, Lord, that you would be pleased, Lord, with what takes place here tonight. That you would be pleased with our heart, Lord, with our mind tonight, Lord. Would you speak to us as we gather, Lord? Lord, our reward is seeking you, Lord. We've come here to seek you, Lord. We come here to meet with you, Lord. Would you meet with us? Would you speak into our life right now? Speak into our situation? Speak into our circumstance? You know what it is, Lord. So we submit these things to you, Lord. We entrust ourselves, we commit ourselves over to you tonight, that you would have your way. So we pray all this in Jesus' name, and together we said, amen. Amen. Would you turn around and greet someone before you take your seat today? But what a blessing it is to be in God's house again another Wednesday night. Amen? So good to be in His presence and to really seek Him. Sing those songs, oh Lord, you're beautiful. Your grace, your face is all that I seek, all that I need, right? And that's why we've come tonight, because we are seeking Him. We desire Him. How many of us want the Lord to speak to us tonight? You want the Lord to speak to you tonight? And I am. I do too. And we're going to open His word. We're going to ask Him, Lord, would you speak to us personally right now? Would you speak into our lives? Speak into our situation? Would you reveal yourself to us through your word? And we're going to open up the word and do that. But before we do that and we go to Genesis, I do want to take a moment to talk about us as we look forward to our missions week. Every January, we have a missions week here, and that's the time where we really focus on the evangelistic work on the mission field for that week as we prepare ourselves for this summer and the different trips that are going to take place throughout the year. So being that we are looking forward to missions week at the end of this month, we actually have one of the missionaries that we as a church support, And we recently began this amazing relationship with him. He's here right now. So we said, hey, why don't you come and just give an update of what the Lord is doing at the church. And not only do they have a church, but they also have a school. That reminds me a lot of this church. So please help me welcome Pastor Jay Bentley from Durango, Mexico. Of course.
Okay. Hey, church. Buenas noches. Wow. What an amazing blessing to be with all of you this evening. Just a little bit about ourselves. My wife and I, along with our five children, before we used to have a theme in our house, four and no more, and now it's five and I'm still alive. And so, but the Lord, he's been so good. We just dropped off our oldest son. He's 18, and we just dropped him off on Thursday at CBI out there, Calvary Bible Institute out there in Joshua Springs, kind of out in the middle of nowhere, right? But those are the places many times that God takes us out to the middle of nowhere in our lives to really do a deep work of his spirit. And so I would ask for you to just pray for him too as well during this time in his life. But so me and my wife and my family, we moved to Durango, Mexico, almost going on 14 years now. And I grew up in the city of Santa Ana, kind of in the neighborhood. I was in juvenile hall, involved with the drugs and the gangs. And at 18 years old, the gospel of Jesus Christ set me free. Amen? And so this journey to the mission field was actually a very long journey. I did not want to go to the mission field. I wanted to serve the Lord here in my country, but the Lord had other plans. And like many people, I was called to the mission field on a short-term mission trip and just able to catch that vision, what God was doing, what God wanted to do. And so now after, 13 years being in the mission field, last year we started a Christian school at our church, and we began our school year last year with about 33 kids. And this year, we began in August, we now have about 52 kids. So praise the Lord. It's and our goal is next year to begin high school, and we already have people interested in that. And just I wanted to encourage you. I was thinking about a missionary. His name is C.T. Studd. He was a missionary first to China, and then after that, he went to Africa and spent the rest of his life in Africa. But one of the things that C.T. Studd said in his autobiography, he said this. He says, there's only one life, and soon it will be passed, but only what's done for Christ will last. And so truly, church, if you guys can remember us in your prayers, I would ask for all of you to just help us pray that we would maintain and keep that eternal perspective. As Jesus said in Matthew 10:39, he said, he who finds his life will lose it, but he who loses his life for my sake, he will find it. So if you remember, church, please pray for us. Over these past couple years, we've had the opportunity to know some of the guys. Pastor Chris has come down to Durango a couple times with the team from the School of Ministry. And Pastor Jesse Colon, he's in Zacatecas, which is about a three-hour drive away from us. So Durango, it's a city with about 800,000 people. Please keep us in your prayers. Thank you so much for your love and your support. We love you guys. God bless you.
The Lord is doing such a special work there in Durango, and we really want to pray for Jay, his family that are here, and the church, and all the needs that they have right now as they're looking to see how they can continue to take steps of faith for that school and really be a lighthouse there in the place that they're called to be in. So would you extend your arm out? Let's pray for him and for the church that the Lord would just do a great work there. Lord, Heavenly Father, we thank you for our brother, Jay, his family, Lord, as they've taken the step of faith many years ago, Lord, to go out and to plow the fields of Durango, Lord. Lord, we thank you for the people that you have brought to surround him, Lord, to raise his arms up, Lord, that their lives have been changed by the gospel message there. We ask that you continue, Lord, to prepare the soil for what you are to do there next. That you continue to soften the hearts, that, Lord, you continue to give him breakthrough as he, Lord, is being faithful and diligent in the ministry there. So we ask for favor, for grace upon his life, his family, God. We ask that you would meet them, Lord, right where they're at every single time, Lord. That your hand of grace and, Lord, power, your presence would be with them, God. So we pray for the church, God, Lord, that you would, Lord, always provide for the needs there. Thank you, Lord, for letting us be a part of what you're doing there in Durango, God. And we ask this all in Jesus' name. And together we said, amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord. It's such a blessing to know and to see that not only the body of Christ is here in Calvary Downey, in this city, in Downey, but it extends all around the world. And to see that we are able to be a part of that with our brothers and sisters, because it's not about building a church. It's not about building our church. It's about building the kingdom of God, right? And that's exactly what we want to do. We want to build the kingdom of God, and that involves the entire church all around the world. But we're going to invite you tonight that you would open your Bible with me into the book of Genesis, chapter 17, and we're going to look at the end of chapter 17 through the beginning of chapter 18 as we are continuing to look at the life of Abraham and how the Lord was really taking him and his wife through the school of faith, testing them, stretching their faith, making them flexible so that they can be usable. A lot of times people say, well, I want my life to be used by God. Well, if you want to be usable, then first you must be flexible. And that's exactly the lessons that the Lord is teaching Abraham. He changed his name from Abram to Abraham now. And in chapter 17, he said, your name will now be called Abraham, which means father of many nations, from exalted father to father of many nations. And he reaffirms his promises to him by saying this, I am Almighty God. As Abraham is walking with the Lord, we are learning more about who God is. Notice that this book is teaching us more of the attributes of God, more of the character of God. And he reveals himself to Abraham as he's waiting on him. What does he say? I am Almighty God. I am El Shaddai. I'm God Almighty. I am the all-sufficient God. Now, we have to remember that because it's going to go into the message that we talk about tonight, that he is El Shaddai. He's the all-sufficient God. He's the one who gives richly. He's the one that gives abundantly. He's the one that gives continually, El Shaddai. In fact, we looked at that definition of what that name means. It's the God who has his hand on everything. Tonight, remember that. Maybe you said, well, last week I knew that. Well, you need to know that tonight again. He is the God who has his hand on everything. And whether you're waiting on results, whether you're waiting on the Lord for an answer, whether you're struggling going through a test, he is the God who has his hand on everything. He's all-powerful. He's omnipotent. There's nothing that can stand in the way of God's purposes. There's nothing that can stand in the way of God's plans. That's why tonight the title of the message is God of the Impossible. Would you write that down tonight? God of the Impossible, because we're learning to trust in God Almighty. And as he makes this covenant with Abraham now, he reaffirms it and he gives him a mark, a sign of the covenant. What is that sign of the covenant that now the Lord would bless Abraham and his generations after him? Well, the sign of that covenant was circumcision. And circumcision was the cutting off of the foreskins of the male flesh, representing something very important, that the life of the flesh that once dominated us does not dominate them any longer. We've cut off the flesh, reminding them, you're identifying now to a people that belong to God. With circumcision, you're identifying as now a new ownership that belongs to God. You've cut away the dependency upon the flesh or the fleshly life to a life that is devoted in love with God, to a life of obedience. That's what it means. Ownership and obedience. Now, I want you to know something that we mentioned last week is that circumcision was not ever a means of salvation. There's nothing that we can do. There's no mark. There's no sign. There's no work that we can do as a means of salvation. But it was a mark of separation. Notice, it was an identification that Abraham and all the males in his household would have had to do this as a mark of separation, that they have a relationship, a covenant relationship with God. That God had said, I promise you that as we are in this relationship, I'm going to bless you. And it reminds us to not depend upon the flesh, to not rely upon the flesh, that there's nothing that the flesh can do to make us right with God, but that we're trusting in the Lord that He would, by His Spirit, lead us, not by the flesh, but by the Spirit He lead us as we're devoted in a relationship of love and obedience. But notice what happens there as we pick up where we left off in verse 15 of chapter 17 of Genesis. Because now God has to speak about Sarai. And we know that He changed her name from Sarai to Sarah, shall be her name in verse 15, where it says there, making her name to be called princess, right? And it says, and I will bless her, verse 16, and also give her a son by her, then I will bless her, and she shall be a mother of nations. Kings of people shall be from her. Now we know that a new name represents a new relationship. It represents the type of relationship that God wants to have with Abraham. The type of relationship and promises that God wants to have with Sarai, that now their identity is based off God's promises for them. Do you see that? Our identity is based off of God's promises to us. So He changes their name. He says, now you have a new relationship with me. And you're going to be a mother of kings and of nations. And I will bless her and give her a son. This is God's plan. This is the plan of El Shaddai. This is the plan of God Almighty. Sarai, who was barren, who could not have children, God is again reaffirming she will have a son and be a mother of nations. In fact, kings will come from her. And notice what Abraham's response is in verse 17 as a husband, that you think, well, you know, God, you want to bless my wife, but here's his response. And Abraham fell on his face when he heard this. He said, no way, I can't take this. You're saying I'm going to have another son at this age? But he falls on his face, and what does he do? He laughed. And he said in his heart, shall a child be born to a man who is 100 years old? And shall Sarah, who is 90 years old, bear a child? Now he laughs, trying to rationalize, Lord, what are you saying? Trying to now resolve in his mind, Lord, how are you going to do this? And he spoke about this condition that they were in. How are you going to do this, Lord, in the condition that I'm in? Lord, how are you going to do this in the circumstance that I'm in? I'm 100 years old. She's 90 years old. That there's no possible way that you can now begin a new work in us. Oftentimes we would say. But how many of us know that God often reserves his greatest ministry of our lives for the final years of our life? That he said, I'm not done with you, Abraham. I'm not done with you, Sarah. I still am going to do a new work. I'm going to now give birth to a new work by the Spirit, even now in your life. Now, Abraham is laughing. And the reason why he's laughing is because he knows it's impossible by all outward appearances. Oftentimes, God does that. He says, I'm going to do something. And you say, well, that doesn't make any sense. But God does things outside of the normal expectation. Outside of what we expect. Outside of our understanding. He didn't know how God would do this. But God could perform it. And notice here, he laughs, trying to come up with a solution. Has God ever told you he's going to do something in your life and you laugh about it? Maybe you try to rationalize. You come up with a plan or with an answer. Lord, I'm trying to find a solution as to how you're going to do this. And what was the solution? What was in Abraham's heart there in verse 18? And Abraham said to God, oh, that Ishmael might live before you. Lord, I don't understand how you would ever do that for me and my wife. Give us a son. But Lord, would you consider Ishmael? Would you notice him, Lord? He brings him up to him. Lord, would you pour your special blessing? Would you like him under your blessing right now that you spoke about? Would you use Ishmael for this? Why? Because he didn't understand. And sometimes when we don't understand what God wants to do, what do we quickly do? We want to make suggestions. We want to make recommendations. Lord, I know you want to do this, but would you do it this way? Would you do it according to my desire? Or you use my way or my plan? But notice, oftentimes, what you desire is not necessarily what God desires. Because he has his own plan as to how he will unfold this plan. So what do we see? That Abraham believed God's promise, but he doubted God's process. And we have to be very careful that we don't only trust God in the plan, but we also trust God in the process. Maybe God's already told you, revealed it through your word. Hey, this is going to happen. The promise is there, but trust also the process. The process involves time. The process involves waiting on the Lord. And here you have Abraham still trying to use the work of the flesh, Ishmael, when he went and had this son with Hagar, looking to use the means of a work of the flesh, attempting to use the work of the flesh to receive the blessing from God. And this is a warning for us, that we would never try to receive God's blessings in disobedience. That we would never try to receive God's promises through works or through means of the flesh. That we would let God, by his Spirit, bring those things to pass. That we would not have to strive or manipulate or to try to fabricate a work of the Spirit. And here he's saying, Lord, would you consider Ishmael? Would you use him, the work of the flesh, to bring your promises about in our lives? And notice what he says here. Because God rebukes him in verse 19. And notice, it's the very thing that we need to hear maybe even tonight again. And God said, say it out loud with me. What did he say? No. Sometimes we like to hear, Lord, thank you for saying yes. You know, the Lord answers three ways to our prayer life. He answers yes, he answers no, and then oftentimes he answers not yet. And we have to be able to discern his voice. Here, God is rebuking his unbelief. And we have to be grateful when the Lord says no to us. You know what this means? That God is directing our steps. Lord, thank you for shutting that door because it means that you have a plan and you are directing me. You are guiding me. I want to follow your leading. God doesn't need an alternate plan. Notice that. God doesn't need a substitute plan, a substitute process. He says, Sarah, your wife, will bear a son and you will call him Isaac. You know what Isaac means? It means he laughs. And it would be a reminder to his father Abraham of his initial reaction of that promise, of that covenant, of his initial reaction of this. And notice what he says in verse 19, and I will establish my covenant with Isaac, whose name means he laughs, with him for an everlasting covenant and with his descendants after him. I'll establish it through Isaac. And not only through Isaac, but also it's going to be everlasting. It's not going to end. It's going to be from generation to generation. God repeats his promises because he's faithful. This is the third time he's saying this, this Abrahamic covenant. He said it in chapter 12. He said it in chapter 17 again here that we're seeing it. One time after the other, that the blessing would come through the son of promise. Like there's a practical lesson for us to learn there in verse 19. That all who seek to live by faith, I want you to know this. Abraham is learning to walk by faith. All of us who seek to live by faith, when God is preparing a promising future. And I say promising because it's based on his promises. When God is preparing a promising future for you, don't cling on things of the past. And I want you to get that tonight. Because Abraham was still looking to cling from the works of the past to try to accomplish God's promising future for him. Why is it a promising future? Because it's based on God's promises for your life. But when God is working that out, when we're walking by faith, when God is preparing that place for us, we are never to cling with things from the past. Now notice verse 20. And as for Ishmael, I've heard you. I heard what you said. I heard what you've asked. Behold, I'll bless him and will make him fruitful and multiply him exceedingly. He shall beget 12 princes and I'll make him a great nation. There is a promise for him, but this is not the covenant promise that I'm making for this nation. It's going to come through Isaac. So we have a comparison, we have a contrast here that these two boys represent two different births. And the two different births that they represent for us, even in our walk right now, Ishmael is the first birth, is the birth according or after the flesh. Why? Because Abraham and Sarah, what do? They try to now gain that son that God had promised through Hagar, a work of the flesh, impulsive, impatient, in their own strength, in the strength of the flesh. Ishmael reminding us our first birth after the flesh. But Isaac here is the second birth through the Spirit. Because it would be a miracle. It would be a work of God. It would be the promised son. And we know John chapter 6, verse 63, Jesus says it very clearly. It is the Spirit who gives life. The flesh profits nothing. What does the flesh do? The carnal lifestyle that we are born into, it profits nothing. It may give you temporary pleasure, but it profits nothing. The birth of the flesh profits nothing. The work of the flesh profits nothing. It is the Spirit who gives life. We are to live according to the work of the Spirit that God is doing in our life, where He's working in us, the regeneration of the Holy Spirit. You know what Ishmael represented? It represents man's fleshly way of accomplishing something for God. We should be very careful that we don't lean on our own understanding, on our own methods, on our own programs, on our own likings and pleasures as ways of accomplishing things for God. Because Isaac, this miracle baby that we're about to know and learn about, he's born by the power of God. And it's awesome when you see a work of the Spirit, it's so obvious, it's God. You don't have to force it. You don't have to try. You don't have to strive. Notice, it's not a work of the flesh. It's a work of God that is born by the power of God. That's why everything that we do, we have to say, Lord, we want this to be a work of God, that it's born out of the power of God, that it's born out of a miracle, a work of God. And constantly say yes to Isaac in our lives, yes to the son of promise in our lives. No to the Ishmael that always wants to strive, that always wants to work things out in your own strength, in your own power, your own dream that you can produce. Think about that. That's the Ishmael, my own plan that I want to produce, my own agenda, my own thing. And we go to the Lord with Ishmael, just like Abraham did. Lord, would you bless my plan? Lord, would you bless my agenda? Lord, would you bless my desire? This is my thing. Lord, bless this. And the Ishmael in us, that desire, that plan, the agenda, those things must die so that the work of the Spirit that God has already prepared in us, the work of the Spirit, can live. We're not to go to the Lord and say, Lord, would you bless the work of the flesh? God does not bless the work of the flesh. God's hand, God's anointing will not be on that which has the fingerprints of man. You know what we want to do when we see things that the Lord is doing? That it would have all the fingerprints of God. That it would be very obvious and evident that we have yielded up the work of the flesh, our aspirations, our desires. We said, Lord, we give that all up to you. Knowing that you have a perfect plan, And knowing that your plan is best, that yes, it may be painful to give up that plan. It may be painful to give up that desire. It may be painful for us to say, we renounce this, we relinquish this, we surrender this cherished dream of ours. But notice this, God's way is always the right way. Abraham had done things the wrong way. Now he's learning to do things the right way. And I pray, if you've done things, you have done things the wrong way recently by the works of the flesh, in disobedience and rebellion and compromise, that you would say, I'm giving up that plan. I'm giving up that agenda. I'm giving up that desire so that only the work of the Spirit would be alive in my life. And notice what happens here next. In verse 21, he goes into detail, but my covenant I will establish with Isaac, the work of the Spirit, born by the power of God, whom Sarah shall bear to you at this set time next year. Notice what God does. He confirms, he gives a promise, and he says, this time next year, 1 year of waiting again. Why? Because God is a God of process. And right now, maybe you're still waiting and saying, Lord, is it really going to happen? Well, it has. If God said he will do it, trust him, it will be done. And he's talking to him. He finished talking to him. And notice what it says in verse 22. Then he finished talking with him, and God went up from Abraham. What does this mean? He was talking to him. It means that he was listening. But not only was he listening, he was ready to obey. Notice verse 23. It says, so Abraham took Ishmael, his son, and all who were born in his house, and all who were bought with money every male among the men of Abraham's house, and circumcised the flesh of their foreskins that very same day as God had said to him. What did he do? He obeyed. And this doesn't look like any type of obedience. This looks like immediate obedience. Because it says that after God left, after he was finished speaking with him, after Abraham had received his orders, you know what happens after we receive our orders from the Word of God? It is now our responsibility. We are then held accountable to then carry out those orders. To fulfill those orders. And what happens here, it says, that day everyone in his house was circumcised. The cutting away of the flesh, of the foreskins, of the males were cut off that day, the same day, just as God had said to him. What was it done? Just as God said. When? On that very same day. What does it teach us? He did not delay. He didn't procrastinate. If God's speaking to you right now, if he's telling you what to do, don't delay. Don't procrastinate, because delayed obedience is disobedience. And what does Abraham do right here? He completely obeyed as to what's going to happen with all his servants, with all those that lived in his house. And think about what would have happened there. He calls a house meeting. Think about it. He says, all right, I just received orders from headquarters. All the men step forward. We're going to get circumcised. And they have to be thinking, excuse me, what did you say, Abraham? Abraham, you're 100 years old. Are you crazy? But they follow him because he has spiritual influence in the home. It may not make sense, but they're following him. They're submitting to it because he has spiritual influence in the home. And notice how it describes it. Verse 24, Abraham was 99 years old. This was painful at 99 years old when he was circumcised in the flesh of the foreskins. And Ishmael, his son, was 13 years old when he was circumcised in the flesh of the foreskins. Now, why do we say that this was painful? Because oftentimes, when God calls you to do something, it may be painful. But notice, he's calling you to do things so that we would cut away the flesh every single day of our hearts, and we would no longer live with compromise so that we can live in obedience to him. Notice what he was asking him to do. 13 years old, 99 years old. He tells everyone in the house that they would have to be circumcised. In verse 26, that very same day, Abraham was circumcised and his son Ishmael. When? That very same day, he obeyed instantly, immediately, spontaneously. And all the men of his house, born in the house or bought with money from a foreigner, were circumcised with him. Now, I just think about what Abraham said. He said this, you can stay in the house, but you must obey these terms. There are terms in order to live in the house. You know what the terms look like? The terms look like obedience. This was his faith in God demonstrated by his obedience. Do you see that? His faith there, his trust in the Lord is demonstrated in his obedience. What we really believe will be shown in our actions. Because we can say we believe everything that we read. We can say, well, I believe that message that I heard. It really spoke to me. But you know, you truly believe what you have received if you have obeyed it. You know, Abraham, he didn't have to pray about it. He didn't say, you know what, I know God said this. I'm going to pray about it. Let me just grow on it a little bit. Let me just, you know, let it really sit in my heart. Oh, you know, I'm going to transition into this because God is calling me to do this. It's just going to take me a few steps until I really do this. No, God said it, and then he did it. You know what this looks like? Wisdom. It looks like wisdom. And he does it without exceptions. There's no exceptions. And I want you to know here today, there are no exceptions. Everyone here must deal with the flesh. Everyone here must cut away the flesh in the heart, in the inside heart. We must be circumcised in our hearts, as God had told the nation of Israel. We must no longer be stiff-necked. Because once the flesh dominates us, we no longer are able to hear the voice of God. And then we're living outside of God's will. So when the Bible says that Abraham was a righteous man, notice he was a righteous man long before he was circumcised. His circumcision simply manifested his obedience and his heart of faith and trust to the Lord, that he was demonstrating that he truly trusted God in that he obeyed. Now know this, God will honor the man, God will honor the woman who honors his word. God's about to honor Abraham. But God honors the man who honors his word. Are you honoring his word right now? Is it the authority in your life? Because the life of faith is a life of obedience to the known will of God. He knows the will of God now. The life of faith is a life of obedience to the known will of God. And you know what he receives later on in Scripture? Abraham, he receives a special title that no other man of God is highlighted with this title, and it's friend of God. In Isaiah 41:8, it says, the Lord says, but you, O Israel, my servant Jacob, who have chosen the descendants of Abraham, my friend. Why does he call him my friend? Because he had a special relationship with him. Of promises, of obedience. In James 2:23, it says, and the scripture was fulfilled, which says, Abraham believed God, and it was accounted to him for righteousness, and he was called a friend of God. Now, why was he a friend of God? Because he obeyed, because he had this special relationship of hearing the voice of God, trusting God, and obeying God. Now, as we share relationship with the Lord, as we come into communion with the Lord, you know what we share? We share his love. We share his fellowship. And we too can know his will for our lives through his word. But you know what fellowship involves? Fellowship and friendship, all of this involves. It really tells us what the next portion of chapter 18 talks about, but it involves ministry. Fellowship involves ministry. Remember that tonight. And he ministers Abraham to three different areas unto the Lord. He ministers unto the Lord. He ministers to his home. You're going to see that there in the few verses that we'll read right now. But he also ministers to a lost world. He's called a friend of God because he fellowshiped, because he obeyed. And out of that fellowship comes ministry. Ministry is an overflow of fellowship with God. Ministry is an overflow. That means that I'm spending time with the Lord. I'm fellowshipping with the Lord. I have intimacy with the Lord. Out of the overflow of that time, then comes ministry. Our first ministry must be ministering to the Lord. That should be it. Spending time with the Lord, ministering to the Lord, serving him. If we fail to bless him, we'll never be a blessing to anyone else. And we have to get that straight. Because what good is it if you're doing so much for other people and God's not even pleased with it? You missed the mark. What good is it if you're doing so much for other people, but God is not pleased with it? Your first ministry is to minister to the Lord. If you are not blessing Him in that, you are not a blessing to anyone else. Genesis 18, verse 1. Notice how he ministered to the Lord. It says, then the Lord appeared to him by the terebinth trees of Mamre, as he was sitting in the tent door in the heat of the day. Now, I want you to underline here, then the Lord appeared to him. Because he appeared to him in a different way now. He revealed himself to him. Here's an appearance to him. Here the word Lord is the Hebrew word Yahweh. And he appeared to him as he was sitting by that oak grove belonging to Mamre. He was sitting by the tent door in the hottest part of the day. But the Lord appears to him in a theophany. What is that? It means that he appeared to him in human form before the incarnation. We believe that it was Christ here that appeared to him in the Old Testament as a theophany, a representation of who Christ is, Christ himself there in the Old Testament. Now, why do we think it's Christ Jesus? Because God has says in his word that no one will see him and live. So we see the Lord here that it represents that Jesus here appears to him with two other messengers. And if you read through scripture, messengers are what? Angels. Now it's important that when the Lord visits, it's very important that we put ourselves in a very important position to hear. When the Lord visits around, if he's visiting you, if he's wanting to spend time with you, you know what our responsibility is? Put yourself in a position to hear. Sometimes we say, well, I go to church, I don't receive from that guy. I don't receive, you know, and we think, oftentimes, we think the problem is with the transmitter, someone once told me. That oftentimes, the problem is not the transmitter, because it's all the word of God. You know what the problem oftentimes is? The receiver. Here, the receiver positions himself in a place to hear from God. He tunes in. He places himself in a place where God would speak to him. And notice what it says here. So he lifted his eyes, and he looked, and behold, three men were standing by him. When he saw them, he ran from the tent door to meet them, and he bowed himself to the ground. What is that position that he's placing himself in? He bows down in humility. He runs to welcome these three men. When he sees them, and in humility, he bows down. What is bowing down? A symbol of humility. It's a symbol of submission. Not only do you see an appearance, but you also see adoration. He's there adoring him. He's flexible. What does he do here? A man that is now in his later years in life, and notice what happens. What does he do when he sees? He lifts up his eyes when he sees these three men, and he runs from the tent door. This is amazing, the urgency. He runs. He runs to that visitation. It's been said before, we've heard it many times, blessed are the flexible, for they shall not be what? Broken. Abraham is so flexible to receive this appearance, this visitation from the Lord. But notice he's eager, he's excited, he's humble. And with expectancy, he gives reverence to the presence of the Lord. The Lord appeared to him. He gives reverence to the presence of the Lord. How does he worship the Lord? In humility. You know, we need to worship the Lord in humility. That's why we come and we raise our hands. We give our worship to the Lord because he's worthy. But humility in worship is first, number one, is recognizing who God is. And then recognizing who we are before God. That's humility in worship. Number one, recognize who God is when you come and worship, when you worship at home. Do you know who God is? And after you know who God is, humility in worship is knowing who you are before him. What happened in Isaiah chapter 6? He said, I saw the Lord high and lifted up, and his train filled, the glory of the Lord filled the temple. I knew who God was, Isaiah. And then I saw my sin before a holy God, and I said, woe is me, I'm undone, I'm a man of unclean lips, for my eyes have seen the Lord. Worship is knowing who God is and knowing who you are before him. Now, you know what the Bible says is that he gives grace to the humble. God resists the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. Here, Abraham is putting himself in a place to now humble himself to receive grace from this appearance. In the East, hospitality is one of the first laws in the life of their culture. He was very faithful to fulfill and to obey this. He learned that he was entertaining strangers or angels. Hebrews chapter 13, verse 1 and 2, what does it say? Let brotherly love continue. Hebrews 13, 1. Let brotherly love continue. Do not forget to entertain strangers, for by doing so, some have unwittingly entertained angels. Don't forget to show brotherly love and to serve people you don't know. How many times do you serve people that you know? I love, it's so easy to love who you know. It's so easy to serve the people that you know. And oftentimes you say, well, you know what? I come to church and I only speak to those people that I know. Or you serve those that you know. But what about the people that you don't know outside of church? Here he's serving angels. You never know who the Lord is going to put before you to serve. So Abraham comes and he's ministering to the Lord personally through hospitality. I love that, hospitality. The Bible speaks of hospitality so much. Notice, number one, hospitality is in that he showed urgency. What did he do? He ran. He humbled himself. Verse 3, what does it say? And he said, my Lord, if I've found favor in your sight, do not pass on by your servant. My Lord, that name for the Lord there is Adonai. He's saying, my master, my ruler, I'm your servant. I'm submitting to you. If I have found favor, if I have found grace in your sight, if you would just give me grace, Lord, stop for a while here and don't pass on by your servants. He knows who he is before God. Don't pass on by, Lord. Would you just stay with your servant right now? Why? Because those who know him will be active, will be moving to serve the Lord. And you notice what he says, I must serve you. Don't pass on by your servants. I pray that that would be our heart today. Lord, if I found grace in your heart, would you not pass over me? Would you not pass me on by? Would you stop? Would you let me serve you? Don't pass me on by, Lord. Would you stay? And notice verse 3, what does he say? Do not pass on by your servant. Please let a little water be brought and wash your feet and rest yourselves under the tree. I must serve you. Please rest a little bit in the shade of the tree. Let me bring water out to you. Let me wash your feet. Notice how he's receiving the reception that he wants to give unto the Lord. He says, Lord, I want to receive you. Please stay. Don't pass on by your servants. Show me grace. Let me serve you. Allow me to serve you. That's the attitude to have. When it comes to ministry, when it comes to worship, our attitude should be, Lord, would you allow me to serve you? How many times do we say, you know what? They need help. Don't ask me. I want you to know this. It's a privilege to serve the Lord. The Lord has given us the privilege to serve. We are allowed to serve the Lord. And he says, would you rest in the shade of this tree? And notice he continues verse 5. And he says, and I will bring a morsel of bread that you may refresh. Circle the word refresh. This is what we are called to do. Refresh one another in hospitality. Here he's allowing room to give rest to the hearts of his visitors there. Refresh your hearts that after you may pass by, and as much as you have come to your servant. Again, calls himself his servant. But what does he say? Would you allow me to refresh your hearts? Well, that's amazing. As we serve the Lord, we would say, Lord, would you allow us to refresh your hearts? Would you allow us to bless you? Lord, would you allow us to provide that for you? Would you, Lord, be pleased in the service that we're going to give you? Before you return on this journey, he's saying, since you have come to your servants. You know, Abraham realized that this visit was providential. What does this mean? That this visit had a purpose. And he was saying, Lord, do not pass me on by without allowing me to serve you. Do not pass me on by your presence without allowing me to refresh your heart. Verse 5, as he continues, notice what it says here. They said, do as you have said. An attitude of a servant, available, willing, humble. You want to know what the attitude of a servant is? One that's going to be used in ministry? One that's available. One that's humble. But also one that's willing. One that's willing. What good is it to be available if you're not willing? And here he was willing. He wanted to refresh the heart of the Lord by serving him, by giving hospitality, by demonstrating generosity. He was waiting for the promise, and I want you to hear this out tonight. He was waiting for the promise, but as he waited for the promise, what was he doing? Serving. If you're waiting for the promise right now, God has said, he's already confirmed it in his word. He said, I have a promise for you. As you wait for that promise to be fulfilled, be busy serving the Lord. Don't say, you know what, I'm going to wait until I get into that season. And when the Lord gives me that season, then I can't wait. I'm just going to serve the Lord with all my heart and strength. No. Start right now, right where you are. As you're waiting on the Lord for that season, serve him. He was ministering to the Lord immediately. Notice the urgency in verse 6. So Abraham hurried. First he ran, then he hurried. This is the kind of people we want to be in ministry. We don't say, you know what, I'm going to take my time. I'll do it later. I don't really want to do it today. There's an urgency. You notice there's a passion that here the Lord is giving him the permission and the privilege to serve him, to refresh his heart. And notice what he goes in verse 6. He quickly hurried into the tent and said quickly to Sarah, make ready 3 measures of fine meal, knead it and make cakes. His wife's in the tent and he told his wife, Sarah, quickly, come on. I need you to serve the Lord with me now. Don't waste any time, he tells his wife Sarah. Quickly make bread. This is a man of faith. And a man of faith, notice this, does not delay when it comes to serving the Lord. A woman of faith does not delay when it comes to serving the Lord. He goes into his tent and he tells his wife, we're serving the Lord. Make 3 large measures of fine. Circle the word fine there because you know what it means? Best. The quality, the best now flour that you have, and make some bread because we're going to serve them. This is hospitality. When you're demonstrating hospitality, I pray that you know how to receive people, that you offer them the best. You know what he's offering the Lord? The best. Quickly. Don't offer the Lord your leftovers. Sometimes we say, well, you know what? We bought this new couch for our house. It's the best couch you could find. So we think we're going to give the old one to the Lord now. Give him the best. Give him the first. And not only does he doesn't stop there. Notice what he says in verse 7. And he ran to the herd of the and took a tender and of the good calf and gave it to the young man. And he hastened. Another word for saying he urged them quickly to prepare it. He was doing everything quickly. He was being timely. When it comes to serving the Lord in ministry, time is of the essence. When it comes to serving the Lord in ministry, hear me out. Time is of the essence. Now, one of the things we see here that not only is he serving the Lord, he's a leader. What does he do? He serves him personally. He says, I'm going to wash your feet. But then he goes to the tent. He gets his wife involved. Then he goes out and he gets his servant involved as well. He involves others. He encourages others. He inspires others to serve the Lord, not to just watch him, and he does everything. I pray that you go back today and you encourage others to serve the Lord. But it's not just you doing everything. You say, you know what? If I need to go home and encourage my husband, if I need to go home and encourage my wife or my kids, whatever it would be in your life, and that we're going to tell them, the fine flour, take it out, the best. We're going to give the Lord our best. We're going to be generous with how we serve the Lord. We're going to do it quickly. They don't need to ask us, these visitors. We don't need to be asked. We're going to step out in faith with initiative and demonstrate. Why? Because people are waiting. Why? Because we're waiting on the Lord. You think about when you go to a restaurant and you have a server. What does the server do? The server is waiting on you. What are we doing as servants? We're waiting on the Lord. Whatever the Lord is asking of us, we're there to serve Him, giving Him our best. What a contrast in comparison to Malachi chapter 1, verse 6. What were the people doing? The Lord told them through Malachi the prophet, "Why are you bringing me offerings? And God is not delighted that you're not giving Him your best." You know what you're giving in your offering? You're giving defiled lambs, lambs that are blind, offering that's lame, these lambs that are sick. And God had clearly said, whatever you offer to the Lord, it must not be defiled. And you think you could just give God whatever you want? You think you just give and put whatever on the altar? No, God does not want that. God wants the first. God wants the best. This is what it means to serve the Lord. And notice what it says in verse 8. So he took butter and milk, the calf he had prepared, and set it before them. He sets before them the bread and the calf and the milk, and he stood by them under the tree as they ate. I love this. What does he do? And he waits on them. He doesn't say, well, I brought it. I'm good. I get to leave now. No, what does he do? He waits until they're done. He says, here it is, and now I'm going to step back a little bit, and I'm going to wait. I'm going to stand on the tree as they eat. This is an attitude, notice, not only of urgency, but an attitude of readiness. What can I do next? How can God use me next? How can I serve Him next? This has to be our heart today, I pray. That today your heart would be, you're serving with initiative. That today your heart would be, I'm serving with urgency. Notice that, I'm serving with urgency. I'm serving with initiative. But number three, I'm serving also with excellence. I want to give Him the best to the Lord, that we would invest our lives into the work of the ministry. Sometimes we come to a big church and we say, well, they have every need that is met. They don't need my help. Yes, there's so many needs. Sometimes people don't even know what the needs are. I'll tell you, before the service happened today, the whole side of the building, the toilets were backed up. But praise God that the Lord provided, and now they're not backed up anymore, right? There's so many needs in the house of God. There's so many needs in the ministry. And you know what our responsibility is? It's to say, Lord, we want to minister to you with initiative. We want to minister to you with urgency. We want to minister to you with excellence. Invest our life. But notice how he's serving the Lord with hospitality. And we're going to talk a lot about hospitality, not only tonight, but next week. I want to give you a final section for us to read right now, and then we'll talk about hospitality again next week. Hospitality is important in ministry. Hospitality is important in your life as a Christian. Hospitality is important in your life as a Christian. That not only you would have an open heart, but you know what happens if you have an open heart? You also have an open hand to give and to receive people. To give and to receive people. Romans chapter 12. Let's turn to our Bibles there as we end tonight. Romans chapter 12. And this is a life as a response of God's grace as a living sacrifice on the altar. This isn't a life as an offering, a life as a sacrifice, a life in obedience, in response to God's mercy, in response to God's grace. Here it is there. The response there, after having given the charge and the exhortation, the command to present our bodies a living sacrifice, if you go to Romans 12, verse 9, notice what it says. Let love be without hypocrisy. Don't just say you love, actually demonstrate you love in action. Abhor or hate what is evil, hate it. And not only should we hate what is evil, we should also cling to what is good. Embrace it. Hold on to it. Don't let that go. Verse 10, be kindly affectionate to one another. Be kind. Affectionate means that you're gentle to one another with brotherly love, that you love one another as a family. Notice, in honor. Give people honor. We want to develop a heart of honor, a culture of honor here, a culture of hospitality here. Where we honor one another, giving preference to one another, that we say, you first and then me. That's the heart of Christ, of a living sacrifice, of a life on the altar. But notice what it says here, not lagging in diligence. Don't be a lagger. If God's calling you to serve in the ministry, don't say, well, you know, I'll wait until someone asks me. You sign up. You do the work of an evangelist. You go fulfill your calling in ministry. Don't be a laggard. And when it comes to diligence, be diligent, fervent in spirit. What does it mean? Passionate, fired up. And notice the next word, serving the Lord. Serving the Lord. Rejoicing in hope, patient in tribulation, continuing steadfastly in prayer that you would maintain a diligent spiritual walk in prayer without being moved, distributing to the needs, verse 13, of the saints, being willing to meet the needs of those in the church, given to what? Hospitality. Given to what? Hospitality. Let's pray. Lord Heavenly Father, we come before you. And we want to be given to hospitality. That we would have an open hand to not only give, but also to receive people, to serve them. Lord, thank you for the many lessons we're learning here through the life of Abraham. That he ran, he urged, he quickly hastened with an attitude of urgency, of initiative, of excellence. Lord, what an example we have that our faith is demonstrated in our obedience. It's not about how much we say, but what are we willing to do? It's not about how much we say, Lord, are we willing to do for you? Thank you because you've already done everything. Ministry is an overflow of fellowship. And I pray that we wouldn't be laggards pretending that we can just now be lackadaisical and sit back and do nothing. Move us into action. At 100 years old, Abraham was moved. Ministering to the Lord so that we can minister to others. Being a blessing to the Lord so we can be a blessing to others. So Lord, we want to minister to you. We want to be a blessing to you. Would you stand with me today? Let's all stand together. We ask God that you would use this people. Would you use this church to be a blessing to you? I pray, Lord, that you would be pleased in the things that happen here. That, Lord, that truly they would bless you, Lord. That they would refresh your heart. Lord, we're waiting on your blessing. We're waiting on your promise. And as we wait, we'll serve. As we'll wait, we'll be waiting on you in ministry. Lord, we know the promise is coming. But in the process, we'll serve you, Lord. In the process, we'll obey, regardless of how painful that looks like, in giving up our own fleshly desire. Regardless of what it costs us, Lord, we turn that desire into you so that we can be useful to you. Because as long as we hold on to it, we're no longer useful. So let us serve you with this heart of readiness, of trust, of obedience. And we pray this all in Jesus' name. Together we'd say, amen. Amen. We're going to do one last song and then we'll be dismissed. If you need prayer, the pastors are going to be up here in the front to pray for you. But I do want to remind you, this upcoming Wednesday, again, just like they said, this place is going to be full. So make sure you come on time and you're ready because the film is going to start right on time. And you're going to be so blessed. I've seen the movie, and it really is a great illustration of what the Lord did as he birthed the movement of Calvary Chapel. And now that we get to stand in that place of what God did then, but also looking forward to what he's going to do next. Amen? Awesome. So let's do one last song, and then we'll be dismissed.
The sun sets free. Oh, it's free. Around, I worship you.